In Last Night in Soho, Thomasin McKenzie plays Eloise, a young aspiring fashion designer who moves from her rural home in England to the big city of London to study at the London College of Fashion. When she comes to the big city, it's not all she thought it would be, and she starts to retreat into a dream world, the London of the 60s. And in this dream world, she meets the dazzling wannabe singer Sandy, played by Anya Taylor-Joy. But these glamorous dreams are not all that they seem to be, and then the cracks start to show and the story begins.
The bartender said I should get to know the handsome fella standing next to Cilla Black.
You should. And you are?
The next, Cilla Black.
Are you now?
I had had the idea for the story for a number of years, and then when I first said out loud that I wanted to make the movie to Naira, which I think was about in 2012, because I was busy at that point even making another film, I said, what I'd really like to do is research it, because there's the idea you have with the story, which is based on your knowledge of the 60s and your perception of the 60s. But I thought it would be really vital to really research the decade and research every facet of the story. So Lucy Pardy, who is a brilliant researcher and casting director, BAFTA award-winning casting director, in fact, that we'd worked with before on Attack the Block. She started researching the period, and I gave her different subjects that I wanted to, and she was able to talk to people who were really there from all walks of life. And really the research that came out of that, which was done over a number of years, I feel, is like the size of a phone book and could probably... you could write 100 stories from it. And it's incredibly sobering reading to sort of read some firsthand accounts of like the much darker side of the area. You know, it was incredibly fascinating and moving and disturbing to do all of this research. But it was a really important thing to do, and there's only really a couple of films that I've done where I felt the need to do research. All very different movies. Like, strangely, Hot Fuzz was very informed by a lot of research about the real police. You wouldn't necessarily think that from the finished film, but it's true. Baby Driver, like, was also... I managed to talk to a lot of, you know, kind of ex-criminals and ex-convicts. So with this, obviously, like, the Soho itself is so steeped in history, it was like... even the enormous tome of research that we have is only like, you know, 1% of like the stories within.
Hello, you're a gorgeous creature. What's your name?
Sandy.
Care to join my friends and I, Sandy?
Thanks, but I'm here to meet the owner.
I am the owner.
Oh, I doubt that.
I'm whatever you want me to be, Sandy.
When Eloise travels to the 60s, we wanted the film to feel a little different at that point, and there were a couple of things we did to achieve that. One was the just about kind of palette control, in terms of we wanted the 60s to explode in color. You know, obviously, like a lot of archive of the time, there's lots of black and white photography, or like, you know, like TV at that time wasn't necessarily in color in the mid-60s. But there are a lot of films of the period that are shot in Technicolor. And I always like watching films from the 60s that are shot in like vivid, almost hallucinatory Technicolor. So that was the idea, is that when we go into the mid-60s, we want to feel like we're going from not a black and white film into color, but more like a muted color film into a Technicolor film. Then at a later point in the movie, as like fantasy and reality start to kind of like collide, the colors from the 60s start to invade the real world. So there's a sort of point, I know it was always from like the scene number, because I've got it written as a list, is from scene 80 onwards. Like, that's when like the color of the 60s starts to kind of infect the rest of the movie. Obviously, scene 80 doesn't mean anything to you, but it's stuck in my head as like that's the change. So there are a number of things in that regard where we wanted to make things feel extremely vivid.
I want to speak to the owner.
Owner's not in tonight. What do you want to speak to them about?
I want to be your new headline act.
Where have you played before?
Nowhere.
Who starts at the Café de Paris?
Me.
The irony about casting Anya Taylor-Joy as Sandy is that she was the first actor that I ever told about the movie, long before the first draft existed. When I met her in 2015, I'd just seen her in her debut movie, The Witch, because I was on the jury of the Sundance Film Festival that year. So I met her in Los Angeles afterwards. I hadn't planned to tell her the whole story of Last Night in Soho, but I did. And so she's sitting there opposite me having coffee going, oh, wow. She goes, that sounds amazing. I want to be part of that. And the irony is that I was initially thinking about her playing the part of Eloise. And because I just saw her in The Witch and said, she's the perfect person to be the Eloise character in Last Night in Soho. So that was what I thought about as I was, the next couple of years went by, I made another film. And then when I was starting to write Last Night in Soho with Christy Wilson-Cairns, the character of Sandy was getting bigger. It was sort of, as we started to write, we started to expand the Sandy scenes, both in terms of how many of them there were, how much dialogue there was in those scenes, and it became clear to me that Anya should be playing that part. And also because it gives her a chance to light up the screen in a way that if she was that person coming to London and Sandy walked into the Café de Paris and did that dance number or walked into the Rialto Club and sang that song on stage, like any smart person in the room is saying, that lady's a star. Anya has this really timeless quality to her that you think that she could be a movie star in like it now. She could be a movie star in the 60s. She could have been a movie star in the 20s. You know, she could have been a silent movie star. There was something about that idea that started to become really intriguing. So then when I finished the screenplay, having told her about it now for like 3.5 years, then I said, hey, guess what? I've written a draft of Last Night in Soho and I'm sending it to you. But I do not want you to look at the character of Eloise. I'd like you to look at the character of Sandy. So I was a bit nervous about that because I thought, I was hoping that she wouldn't say, oh, I'm not playing the lead anymore. But she read the script, said, I love the script and I would love to play Sandy. And I said, great.
Miss Collins?
Yes?
It's Ellie. We spoke on the phone.
Oh, yes. Room is on the top floor. I have a few rules. Don't take smokers.
I don't smoke.
No male visitors after 8 o'clock.
Not a problem.
And no using the laundry room at night. It rattles right through to mine.
I don't do laundry.
Aye?
I mean, I don't do nighttime laundry. I do laundry, I'm very clean.
Once I decided that Anya should play Sandy and not Eloise, then suddenly it was an open brief. It's like, who is going to play Eloise? And it was actually my producer, Naira Park, who was the first person who mentioned Thomasin McKenzie. And I had seen her in Deborah Granick's Leave No Trace, in which she is incredible, playing Ben Foster's daughter. Such a naturalistic performance that it wasn't something where I wasn't sure, is that a non-actor? Is she an actress? From watching the film, she so completely disappears into that role. I didn't have any sense of that somebody was playing that part. I totally and utterly invested in her character on screen. So then when her name came up, I was like, oh, she played the daughter in Leave No Trace. Well, she's incredible. And I said, how old is she? And, you know, we figured out that she would be exactly 18 when we made the movie, which is exactly the same age as Eloise in the script. So I met Thomasin McKenzie in Los Angeles, and I mean, she's not dissimilar to Eloise in a sense, in terms of she's such a warm, empathetic, kind person. And I guess when I met her, my first thought was that, oh my God, am I really going to put her through this story? So actually one of my first questions was, because she said, oh, I love the script. And I said, was there anything that made you feel nervous about shooting? And she said, no. She later said in an interview that that was a mistake, but I'm so glad that she's in the movie, because I feel one of the real strengths of it is that you get to go on the journey with her. And there's something really powerful about casting somebody who's the same age as the character. Because as Eloise is going from the country to London and on this kind of, you know, kind of incredible odyssey, like Thomasin was also doing that by coming back from New Zealand to London to sort of like be in a movie where also we're shooting in a lot of the real locations. There's a very like visceral experience for her. And Thomasin is one of those actresses who is incredibly naturalistic and wants to feel the experience as strongly as she can. So she really has to put herself in that mindset. And I guess in a way she was able to kind of like, sort of like, I guess this sounds crazy, but she's really able to be in the story. And I was really impressed watching her, especially somebody of that age, to have such skill. And to be in a movie where you're in every single scene. She's the lead of the movie and there's not a scene that she's not in. That's not easy to do. And she pulled it off with aplomb. So I was just sort of amazed at watching her like essentially run this marathon by being in the movie. And I think you experience so much of the movie through her on every level that you needed somebody incredibly special to pull that off. The inspiration for a lot of my movies is sometimes just the longing, the yearning for a genre that I miss, or even the feeling that that genre gives me. And not to say that there aren't psychological thrillers anymore, but there's a certain feeling that I get from psychological thrillers and horrors from the 60s and 70s that is the sort of magic that I would like to try and recapture if I can. So those movies are all sort of like, you know, kind of very clear in my head. And then I guess is sort of my own research for the movie is that I started watching more and more and more dramas of the period from the 60s, British films, revisiting ones that I'd already seen, like John Schlesinger's Darling, or like watching, you know, many, many, many films that I'd never seen before. I guess even though, you know, there are so many genre films being made, and, you know, particularly like the horror genre is something that's never gone away, and in fact is something that is one of the genres that's the most popular at the cinema right now. And I think maybe doesn't have the same stigma attached to it that it used to. And you can see that in terms of when, you know, sort of films that have, you know, kind of horror elements nominated for Oscars, which is something that didn't used to happen quite as much. That said, is that I feel like I'm always like returning to films that sort of thrilled me when I was younger and still thrill me to this day. So, and then not to put myself in this bracket at all, because I don't want to do that, but it is that thing where you're watching like Hitchcock films or films by Michael Powell or, you know, older films by Mario Bava or Dario Argento, and you know, and the films that still stand up and are still thrilling even if they're like 60 years old, those are the ones I keep returning to. Like, so something like Psycho, Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, is a film that has been probably got some of the most parodied scenes of all time. Like, even if you haven't seen the shower scene in Psycho, you have seen somebody do a spoof of it. Like, and it's something that's probably one of the most imitated scenes in history. And you've seen every single frame of it, like, discussed in great detail. And yet, when you watch the scene in the movie, it still works. And that's like a sort of magic trick, is like somehow this movie is casting a spell over me to the point where even something that is like so intensely familiar and analyzed to death still has the power to shock and surprise and you know, kind of like give you goosebumps. And so those are the films I return to, And so there were like many films like in the making of this where it's not like necessarily like making a film with the same plot as these movies, whether it be, you know, like Psycho or Don't Look Now or Black Narcissus. It's just sort of trying to sort of even, and again, I'm not putting myself in the same bracket as these directors, but you're just trying to approach that feeling. It's like that feeling that you get, like I would like to kind of like, I would like to make other people feel like that, how I felt. You know, I always feel like when I saw a film like Silence of the Lambs at the cinema, I saw that when I was 16 years old or 17 years old. And what I remember of that screening of the movie, like it must have been the first weekend it was out in the UK, was not that people were yelling and jumping. It was more like the audience very quickly were sort of terrified into submission. And you could just feel, you could hear a pin drop in any of the quiet scenes, and you could feel that people just like pinned into their seats, and there was just this like electricity in the air. I think it's like when films kind of change like your sort of chemical makeup, or like there's a scene in this movie where, even though I made the movie, whenever I'm watching the scene, I feel like the temperature is dropping in the room, and of course it isn't. Like it's just there's aircon on, but I feel like it's getting colder, and it's like, is my body doing that? It's like sort of, I mean, it's also, I made the movie, so I know what's coming. But I feel like that's something where it's all you're trying to do is trying to sort of create that spell and that kind of like mood and those moments. And the sometimes there are shots in movies that I imagine are much longer than they actually are. There's a shot in Black Narcissus where Sister Ruth, played by Kathleen Byron, comes back into the climax of the movie and makes this very dramatic entrance through a door. And in my head, that's the shot of the movie. And it's like, what an amazing shot. Oh my God, one of the sort of, a shot that's burned into my brain. And then when I watched it again the other day, thinking, oh, that shot is only 2 seconds long. But that's the shot that I would go and I'd be able to draw it. And I could tell you everything that's going on in the frame. And you could sort of feel like that's like sort of, it feels like that kind of 2 second shot in your head is like a sequence that goes on forever. Or like that's the shot that will haunt your dreams. But in reality, it's like over like that. So all of those things, those feelings and the kind of like the sort of the goosebumps or the electricity or the sort of you're feeling that you're getting colder as you're watching the movie. Those are all the things that I just, the reason that I love watching films with an audience or watching them on the big screen or going on a journey into darker territory, like with a film, somewhere you don't want to go. But once you're kind of like, once you're in your seat and you're sitting there in the dark, you know, there's nowhere else to turn unless you literally want to run out of the auditorium.
Do you believe in ghosts?